Happy Monday to everyone. It is May 17th, 2021, and we are 110 days away from kickoff, inching ever so closer to that 100-day mark, which means we'll still have 100 days left, and it's going to be a long summer. But at the very least, things are progressing in the right direction for society. You know, whether you agree with certain decisions made by the CDC or not, it appears that we're going to have as close to a normal college football season as possible. And I'm thankful for that. You know, regardless of whatever you believe, you know, just we're slowly getting back to normalcy. So this is going to be a video of just been things I've been thinking about for a while. Hasn't been a lot of football news lately. I might do some softball stuff. I haven't decided how I'm going to do that yet. But I know there's one or two people said, "Hey, you can do softball stuff." I was like, well, you know, it's something to do, something to talk about with the tournament and everything coming up. OU's number one overall seed, which is awesome. Didn't quite expect that to happen because I thought UCLA or maybe, you know, someone else might have gotten it. But, you know, regardless, OU got it. So anyway, this is a football topic that pops in my head once in a while. And it's just something that, you know, when you look at the overall picture of the sport, especially the big boys, the Power Five conferences, there's always the excitement level. Like, one thing you love to do preseason, especially when schedules get more solidified, you like to go week by week and circle games. Man, can't wait to watch that one. I don't care who you're a fan of. Like, if you love college football, you love to watch big games. You love the excitement surrounding it. So every week you go through week one's full of great games, you know, and so on and so on. But conference matchups, for me personally, when the big conference games happen, that's where you get excited. And the thing with those conference matchups, there's two conferences that really dominate that conversation. The SEC and the Big Ten. I would say the SEC maybe a little bit more. But, you know, the Big Ten's got all these rivalry games that have all these rivalry trophies that some of you have never heard of before. But some of them are my personal favorites because I'm a college football junkie. I love Wisconsin-Minnesota, the Paul Bunyan axe, this big giant axe they play for. It's one of my favorite trophies in all of college football. But you look at the SEC, and some schools have like two to three rivals, like on some in some cases. Like Georgia's got who? Florida, Auburn, and Georgia Tech, so that's three right there. I know Georgia Tech's ACC, but still in state. You know, Florida's got Florida State, Miami, Georgia, you know, Alabama's got Auburn, Tennessee, you know, the list goes on. And then you get to the Big 12, and you ask yourself, Oklahoma, Texas, of course. It's like, Oklahoma, Texas has very under the radar been like one of the top five best games every year, year in and year out, just based on, forget rankings, just based on how the game has gone, competition. It's like, it's always been like a one-score game for about 6-7 years. But you look elsewhere with the Big 12, and one of the problems the Big 12 runs into is that it's a little bit of a Frankenstein of a conference with two power schools holding it together, whether it's by, you know, success on the field or money. You know, the rest of the league, like the big, you know, rivalries just don't seem to be there. They don't exist anymore because a lot of those went away when the Big 12 lost four schools that really held that together. And the Pac 12, you know, as down as the Pac 12 is, like they still have some, you know, rivalries that people pay attention to. And, you know, I would argue that the Big 12 is still in a better spot, but what really brought this on for me personally, I was going back and watching some old games because I'm working on some video projects, and I forgot like what an amazing game the Nebraska-Colorado game used to be, like in the 90s, from like 96 on, from like 96 to 2000, Nebraska won all of those games, but it was without question. You know how I talk about OU Texas being like in a great game year in, year out? That's what Nebraska-Colorado was in the 90s. Colorado had its heart broken so many times, almost beating Nebraska, till they finally just went Ralphie from A Christmas Story on Nebraska in 2001 and screwed up the entire BCS. It was like one of the first really big eye-opening, this is bad for the BCS type of moments, where Nebraska lost big, didn't play in the Big 12 championship game, and still got to go play Miami for the title. But again, you look at these games, and I look at the Big 12, and outside of OU Texas, you might have OU Iowa State, a big game in conference, maybe Bedlam. But the problem with OU Iowa State is that I think everyone here feels comfortable that OU is going to get to the end of the year to late November with 0 or 1 losses. I think that's fair to say. You can't say the same thing about Iowa State. I mentioned in previous videos, it's just, can they get past those early slow starts in September? Can they beat Iowa this year? Can they get through undefeated? That's like a tough ask. They just can't. They just never start strong out of the gate. And, you know, you look at the rest of the Big 12, it's like, who's going to step up? I mean, what other rivals have been? I mean, Kansas, K-State? Kansas has been awful for a while. They haven't been good in over 10 years. So what do? It's hard to break out, to create new rivalries, especially when, frankly, Oklahoma dominates all the time. You know, who's going to be the consistent threat to Oklahoma? It's always somebody different every year. One year it's Texas. Past couple years it's been Iowa State. Before it was Oklahoma State. Before that it was Baylor. I mean, ask yourself this question. I had to really think about this for a moment. When was the last Big 12 conference game that you can think of that had an impact for both teams, mind you, not just one, both teams, a Big 12 conference game that had an impact on a national level at the end of the year, where both teams were involved and had a shot to do something? I really had to think about it, and it was, the only thing I can think of off the top of my head is Baylor TCU 2014. Or it didn't involve Oklahoma. That was like the criteria. It was like a game that didn't involve OU. And I'm like, yeah, it had to have been Baylor TCU. And I'm sure there might be a game somewhere I'm forgetting about that someone can like, well, what about this game or this game here? It's like, or Texas versus Oklahoma State in the middle of the year. But yeah, I know they had like a top 10, top 5 matchup, but they weren't there at the end of the year, though. That's kind of my problem. I mean, Texas was, Oklahoma State wasn't. But TCU and Baylor were fringe playoff teams. Frankly, TCU probably should have been a playoff team at the end of the day over Baylor. That's just my 2 cents on that. But you have all these other teams. Like, the Big Ten has had Ohio State, Michigan State, Wisconsin, Michigan to an extent, although Jim Harbaugh is just a fraud up there. He can't win a big game to save his life. He can't win any big games, let alone he can beat the rest of the Big Ten except Ohio State. Kind of a problem. But still, you have, like, at least at the end of the year, for a lot of years, Michigan, Ohio State was a game that affected the playoff. Do I need to say anything more about the SEC? Bama's usually there, but every once in a while, Utah, I don't know where I'm going there. I was thinking 2007, 2008. Anyway, Auburn is what I meant to say. LSU. You know, Georgia, Florida, you know, you have all these other teams that creep into that conversation on a regular basis. And Big 12 doesn't really have that. There's always, the Big 12 feels like Southpaw regional wrestling, where you have Oklahoma is your heel or babyface champion, depending how you look at it. They're the consistent champion. They're the Ric Flair, the Hulk Hogan, and every time there's a new heel or a new face to compete for the title. And again, one year it's Iowa State, one year it's Texas, one year it's Baylor. But there's no one consistently doing it. And just when you don't have those rivalries that you lost with Nebraska and Colorado, Texas and Texas A&M, you can throw Missouri into that as well. You miss a lot of that history and tradition that you can build on, that you can pull old video of and say, hey, look how great these games were back in the day. There's not a lot of games you can do that with the Big 12. West Virginia's just kind of out there by themselves. I mean, you got a little bit of old Southwest Conference stuff with, you know, Baylor, Tech, Texas, and TCU, but not a lot of those were national-level impactful games over the years. So, I mean, with them, you lost Nebraska, Colorado, you lost teams that won national titles and had an impact in the 90s. And A&M is a psycho fan base, and despite whether, you know, they succeed on the field or not, they're a rabid fan base who cares about college football. And, you know, they were probably the most rabid fan base in the Big 12 before they left. I say rabid in a positive and negative connotation because they're the Aggies. You know, they yell at you if you walk on their grass. And they worship a dog. So, but with that being said, you don't have that anymore. It's in the SEC now. So I guess what I'm trying to say is that with the Big 12, it's just, it's difficult at times to get hyped up for in-conference matchups because you don't have that history and tradition to, you know, to look at or to hold on to, even if the game isn't appetizing with a ranked versus ranked matchup. You got that almost everywhere else. You got at least a little something of that. In the Big 12, you got, what, 2 to 3 games max a year where you could say that or do that, get really hyped up for, and that really grab people on a national level. So it's just another thing OU has to deal with. You know, if OU is not involved, then, you know, no one's really going to care as much. You know, you can call that egotistical, you can call that being spoiled, but it is what it is with the Big 12. You know, a lot of other games outside of the league are more appetizing to watch as a casual viewer. Then that's just the way it is. So let me know what you think. Like, and I kind of rambled a little bit here, but like, does some of you miss the old Big 12? Because like, I look at some of those old games and I do kind of miss them. I didn't miss OU being bad in the 90s. Ugh, you can forget that. But there was that small window, late 90s, early 2000s, where the Big 12 was a lot of fun to watch. And you had a lot of really intriguing games that grabbed people's attention. And it peaked in 2008, even though Nebraska was down and so forth. And they kind of creep back up a little bit with Bo Pelini. But just, you know, that 2009 championship game where they put 1 second back on the clock and Nebraska just, I wish they hadn't left. Wish this never had happened because I thought it was going to be an OU-Texas league. Then it turned into just an OU league with Texas just being involved. But you don't have the regular rivalries anymore like you do. We have one, maybe two a year that you really pay attention to. So anyway, that's just me. Random thoughts I'm sharing today. Boomer Sooner. Y'all have a good one, and we'll see what we can come up with for softball. So you have a good one. Later.